Fulton County Public School System, considered one of the finest educational environments in the entire state of Alabama, has a history beginning in the latter part of the 18th century, when, as records indicate, Alabama's first public schoolhouse was built in the North Baldwin County community of Tensaw in 1799. And at that time, nearly 10 years prior to Baldwin being organized as a county, the area remained geographically expanse. Agriculture served as king, and family farms dotted every section of the county. And in this era of extremely limited highway systems, individual communities built their own respective public schoolhouses, with the Board of Education supplying teachers to provide instruction. In the early part of the 20th century, the Baldwin County Public School System boasted over 80 separate school districts, each with their own individual public schoolhouse. And as time progressed, marked with improvements in transportation and engineering, numerous school districts were consolidated into nearby areas, leaving us today with very few of the original and historic public schoolhouses which distinguished Baldwin County, beginning in 1799, as the birthplace of Alabama's first public schoolhouse. This documentary, commissioned by the Honorable County Commissioners of Baldwin County and Honorable Members of the Baldwin County Board of Education, seeks to illuminate these few remaining and historic original public schoolhouses in an effort to pay tribute to one of the finest public school systems in Alabama. Records indicate that the old Aaronville High School dates back to the 1940s as an educational institution benefiting students of and around the South Baldwin County community of Foley. This historic schoolhouse consisted of four classrooms, which were added in 1957, followed by another three in 1962, and two more in 1963. 1 year later, the first cafeteria was added to the building. As enrollment increased, continual improvements were made to the original edifice. With integration came many changes to South Baldwin's educational system. Aaronville High School became Foley Middle School and remained so until 1990, when the new Foley High School was erected. At this time, the middle school students were combined with fourth and fifth graders, and the facility was renamed Foley Intermediate School. Surviving under the name of Aaronville High School for nearly 50 years, this historic structure, although presently inactive as a high school in Baldwin County, remains a cherished landmark and continues as a functioning schoolhouse to serve the educational needs of Foley's young citizens.
Aaronville School, as I first knew it, was a collection of small wooden buildings that had been moved there, small one-room wooden buildings that had been moved there at some previous time. And during my tenure as Foley High School principal, I watched a whole new school being built there on the same campus. And those old, as I watched those old buildings being torn down and demolished, so that Aaronville School, when it was ready to become a high school, had as modern buildings as any, well, more modern than any other school in Baldwin County that I knew about at the time. They were far better built, far newer and better buildings than on the Foley School's campus. We learned a little lesson about protecting school library books at Aaronville School. Tornado struck there and took the top off the school library, and the top shelf of the library that had been built, it was just a classroom that had been converted to a library, but the top shelf was extraordinarily wide, and it protected the books that were down below it. And we incorporated that lesson everywhere we ever built a library later. And it paid off wonderfully at Baldwin County High School when the fire almost destroyed the library at Baldwin County High School. But we had built those wide shelves at the top, and it largely protected those books. But wherever else we've built a library since, we make the top shelf the widest, twice as wide as any of the other shelves. It pays off when troublesome times come. The first move that was decreed in the integration of Baldwin County schools was to place one teacher, one white teacher in each black school, and one black teacher in each white school. And if maybe the second year of it, maybe that was about doubled. But then when the final decree came in, it simply closed every black school in Baldwin County and integrated them directly into the white school buildings of that area. And it was done without any regard for space. And we had some horrendous space problems at that time. We had to use every available crack and cranny. And then gradually, over the next year or two or three, we were able to get permission to reopen some of the black schools and into the new buildings that existed on those premises. I don't remember exactly how many years before we were able to go back to Aaronville, but it was several as a part of Fuller School. And the same thing at Baldwin County, Baldwin County Training, and the same thing at Douglasville High School out here. Then the space situation was much improved when we were able to reopen those schools. But then that descended on us all of the new programs from the state of Alabama, like kindergarten and special education, and we were back into just as much trouble as we were in the late 60s and early 70s with integration.
At a map of Baldwin County, and you compare the population density from the early part of the 20th century to the late part of the 20th century, there's almost a flip-flop. There were very few people living in the southern part of Baldwin County in the early part of the 20th century, and it began to grow because of several factors at that time. Towns sprang up all across the southern part of the county, primarily due to land developers who had come in and bought huge segments of land, advertised widely across the United States for cheap dirt. You could buy your farms in Baldwin County and own your own piece of America. Many, many people moved, many from northern and midwest states moved to the southern part of Baldwin County. And of course, there were some industries that came in at that time too. About that time, the L&N Railroad built a spur from Bay Minette down to Foley, which stayed in existence for many years, and that aided in the product shipment at that time. One of the big industries that was in Baldwin County, across the county, was the development of turpentine, which many people are not really aware that was a major industry in Baldwin County. Turpentine still. When you look at an old map and you see, say, Mills Still, you will know that was a turpentine plant, a manufacturing still where they actually processed the turpentine for sale. African Americans that moved to Baldwin County at this time came for the employment opportunities that were there, and many of them bought land and have their farms. And the African American communities that are around the Foley area, even today, have people who have been there for more than 100 years. Rich, rich family heritage. Some of them came to buy farms. Some of them came to work in the turpentine stills. Some of them came for the farming industry, which at that time was primarily flower farming. There were huge gladiola farms, even where Foley High School is today, and many people are alive that worked in those flower farms, that flowers that were iced and shipped on the railroad to markets across the United States. Another big product at that time were citrus. Satsumas were a huge industry in the southern part of the county. One of the African-American communities that that we know about in this area was at Mills Still, and it's one of the records of the earliest schools we have. Like most communities, the school would first be held in somebody's house, and the community would get together and build the one-room wooden schoolhouse. Perhaps the school system would come in, and there was also some money from Rosenwald Fund that was a philanthropic organization that provided schools for African-American rural children. The Rosenwald schools are those schools that were particularly built at the early part of the century for those children. One school that we know of was at Mills Still, which was first held in Luther Page home on Little Rock Road off 98 there. And Luther Page hired Lula Kemp, one of the first recordings we have of a teacher in an African-American school in Baldwin County. Another one was at Marlow, which was where the ferry was that would connect the transportation system across what is today County Road 32 to cross Fish River and to be able to get the farm goods to the eastern shore to be put on paddle wheel boats and taken to Mobile to be shipped out. So Marlow was a booming community at that time where the ferry was. A Groves school was there in Marlow, and we know that it was one of the Rosenwald schools that were built. A very large African-American community in the Foley area was Aaronville. And the first school was in someone's home, of course, but then a wooden school building was built on the corner of Michigan and Cedar, which is where the Boys and Girls Club is today, right in Foley, Aaronville community. So for the first half of the 20th century, these wooden building, 1 to 3 rooms at different times, were in existence there, and a Miss Mathis was one of the first teachers. That school was used until the late 1940s, and there are many people today who can remember going to school in those wooden buildings. One of the wooden rooms was moved and is still standing today in Foley, and Mr. Jeremiah Stallworth can remember going to school in that building when it was on the corner of Michigan and Cedar.
I walked 7 miles a day, hobbled on the roof, stayed 90, 7 miles a day. 7 miles a day. A friend bought this here, right there. I met P.K. Ward bought that part. And that's the part somewhere. Somebody, I don't know who bought that. The Bill Boys Club, it's big there. Now, he was Boys Club, Bill Boys Club. Yes, sir. Now, when I was at AML school, my teacher was Miss Matthew. You know, 7 miles, walk 7 miles a day. Be on time. Be on time. 7 miles a day, be on time. Miss Matthew, my teacher. Big game, we played ball out there. Played ball for a while at school. We paid ball for a while at school, you know, and that's all. Paid ball for a while a little bit at school. You know, you ain't got to school, you ain't walk back home. You ain't walk back home. Same place where I club at now. I went to 7th grade. I worked on but my hot tumbling but my front platform with my mama. That's been a long time ago. I worked with my mom there about 17 years. Cutting flour. I got tired of cutting flour in. I got tired of cutting flour for mom. I got married. I moved back there. I got married. All 7th grade in that one school. I ain't going for the 7th grade. I said, I got to go right now. I'm going to have to put my flour for me. I worked with my mama all that. These folks, old folks, yeah, that's me. Oh, yeah. All of them. They did now. They did. Then you begin in sophomore. Here they are. I learned little coming school. Little bit, not much. I learned a little bit, not much in school. I did. I know I'm not in school. I know what I know now. I thought it was gonna fly for me if everything over here. With mama. All, with all these old folk on South Carolina. Yeah, man, but all of them did. So yeah, all of them did. All of them did. The boss, I worked with them on South Carolina. You work five, 7 hours a day on the phone. You're on time. You're on time.
Mr. Jeremiah Stallworth tells us that he walked 7 miles from the Underwoods, where he and his family lived, to go to school at the Aaronville School for grades 1 through 7. He has fond memories of Miss Mathis, who was the principal teacher of the school. He tells us that the wood stove that was in there, that the boys brought wood in to keep the fire going. Of course, no schools had air conditioning at that time. And probably they went to school 3 to 4 months of the year. But he has memories of the people that he went to school with there for grades 1 through 7. And after finishing grades 1 through 7, he was one of the workers in the gladiola farms that are right there in the Aaronville community. Mr. Stallworth is a treasure of memories from the wooden school building in Aaronville. The wooden buildings were used as an elementary school even after part of the new school was built. Now, the new school was built about 1950, between 48 and 52, and it's at the location of where Foley Intermediate School is today. It is still standing as part of that school. Typical of the 1950 buildings that were built in those small communities, it was built of Clay City tile. It was a 3 to 4 room school with the classrooms opening to the outside. Two of the classrooms could be connected by opening a partition. At the end of those classrooms was a stage. And that when the community would meet there in that building, it offered an opportunity for the community to gather and really become a gathering place for many events that were held in these buildings. Evening events and Sunday afternoon teas, and the stage was used for many, many presentations in these small community schools. The cafeteria was added in the early 1960 or so, and when the wooden school was closed and this school had some additional rooms added about 1955. It was serving students grade 1 through 7, and the students who would go on to high school after that were bused. And the buses, of course, at that time were driven by the students themselves, some of the students themselves, and great stories of the sliding off the muddy road into the ditch and students having to push the bus out of the muddy ditch and arrive at Daphne Training School with mud all over them and would have to get washed off before they went to school. And of course, the students that graduated from there, many of those went on to college. In 1966, it was decided to make Aaronville a high school. So after 1966, students could stay there, and they added a grade at a time, and there were 3 graduating classes from Aaronville High School. There are some people today who can fondly remember their years there as a student when it was a high school. One person who can tell us memories of the wooden building and the transfer of the students to the Aaronville High School is Miss Betty Schutz Harris, who was a former teacher and a student at Aaronville School. Miss Harris is part of the Schutz family, who has lived in this area for many, many years and has a strong legacy of the Aaronville School history.
remember attending the Aaronville, I guess it was called the Aaronville School. I was in the, I attended here from first through eighth grade. The first school that I attended in this area was at, on the corner of Cedar and whatever street that is up there. What's that, Cedar and? That was the first school that I attended many, many years ago. And that school ran from first through fifth. From there, I left there and came here. This was considered a middle school. I left this school and went to Foley to Daphne Intermediate. And that was the high school part of it. We rode a school bus. We had to ride a bus 3 years from here. When we graduated from here, I was a salutatory. And we had to ride a bus from here to Daphne the last 3 years of our education in order for us to get high school education. And that was the part where we had to get up real early to catch the school bus. When I finished from Baldwin County Training School, 12th grade, I attended Alabama State University. After I finished from Alabama State University, I came back here and taught 5th grade for 3 years until integration. I was one of the first black teachers that were pulled from here and sent to the Foley Elementary School. I taught 5th grade up there once I left here and went to Foley, it was Foley Elementary at that time. I taught 5th grade there. I was among the first, it was Ms. Herman first and then myself. We were the first two black teachers to leave here and go to Foley into elementary, first integration. I was a guinea pig. The school on the corner, I do remember the wood heaters. I remember us having to walk from the corner school down here for our lunch. We did not have a cafeteria there, so we had to walk from the corner school, I think it was about two buildings there, down here for our lunch, and after lunch we had to walk back up there. And after, I think I came here in the sixth grade, and that was sixth, seventh, and eighth grade. So I graduated, so to speak, from on the corner to this school, which was sixth, seventh, and eighth grade. And I do remember the Chicantala, as they was named it. I also remember the May Day, which we used to get out and plant the maypole. What else we used to have? We used to have contests. And the one who raised the most money was given a prize. And all the children were excited because it was something different. And we had a lot of activities, and we were very dedicated teachers. We had, of course, we had all the secondhand books. We never had new books down here. When we came here, when I came here, my first year teaching, I taught fifth and sixth graders. I had a combination of fifth and sixth graders. And we never had new books. I never had a new desk until I went to Foley Elementary School. That's when I saw the first new textbooks and the first new desk for me as a teacher. I guess at that time, I got my first paycheck. And I looked at it, and it was a small sum of money to me. And I went home and I told my mom, I said, Mom, is this all I'm going to be making? And you've spent all this money on me. Which means at that time, teachers were not being paid like they are today. So that was a little disappointing to me when I got my first paycheck. It was exciting, but yet disappointing, because I thought I would be making much more money than what I was making when I got my first paycheck. But the humor part of it, I guess I've always been a sincere teacher. And the fun, we had fun, but I was, as they used to call me, the very strict teacher. I was very strict, but yet I love my students, and we just did a lot of fun things. And my first year teaching here, I had a lot of nieces and nephews in my classroom, and I treated them as if they were just a student, because to me, they were just students. And when we would get home, they would tell their parents, ooh, Aunt Betty G was so mean to us. She was hard on us than she were the other children. But I saw them as students like the others. But my first year teaching, I did teach quite a few nieces and nephews. They called me Miss Schutz. It was hard for them. Sometimes they would still say Annie, but they most of the time it was Miss Schutz.
The building itself was used as a high school through 1969. And with the integration movement, it was consolidated with the Foley schools. And at that time, the building became Foley Middle School. It served students in Foley as Foley Middle School until the new high school was built in 1990. And at that time, the middle school moved to the old high school, and this school became Foley Intermediate School, and it remains Foley Intermediate School today, serving children in the community.
Native of Foley, born and raised, attended school here where we are sitting actually. This particular room was classroom / auditorium. At the time I attended school, elementary school, we had several small white wooden buildings in the back of this particular facility. I went through those classrooms through grade 3rd. Grade 4th, 5th, and 6th was in this particular wing. Grade 7, 8 were in a newly renovated area just south of here. And my senior class, my high school classrooms, were in the brick rooms on the wing. And I graduated here in 1969. That was the year this school closed as a high school. It was only a high school for 3 years. Prior to that, black students that got an education past the 8th grade had to attend Baldwin County Training School in Daphne. In fact, all of my siblings attended Baldwin County Training School past 8th grade and got their diplomas there. Two brothers were bus drivers. At that time, if you were 16 and had a license, student, you could drive school bus. And two of my brothers drove school bus from Foley, went through Foley, Marlowe, even picked up kids in Fairhope, and they went on to Baldwin County Training School in Daphne. As a student here, I remember those were some of the best days of my life. We were small in number. We were loved. Everybody was your mother and your father. Community school. I didn't live in this community. I lived 4 miles north of here. In fact, as a child, we lived on a farm, and we were the, for years and years and years, we were the only family out there. My dad and mom were farmers. They bought land there in the early 20s, and in fact, we still own the property as we speak. Back to being a student here, I remember very distinctively, as I said, we were very, very loved by everybody. Teachers were our mothers, our fathers. We were disciplined. And of course, once we were disciplined here at school, we were also disciplined at home, because a lot of the teachers, especially my family, I remember very well, a lot of my teachers would spank me, and then they would go home and eat dinner with me in the afternoon, because that was the type of relationship we had. And I think this is very, very unique. Most of the black teachers during that time were from Mobile, but they could not live in Mobile. They had to board in the city in which they taught. So they were board here. They would live here 5 days a week. On Friday, they would go home to their families. That means my parents, a lot of the other parents, were kind of like their adopted parents. And they would come, teach, come out to the house and eat, socialize, and work the next morning. We never did board any, but we fed them a lot of evenings. They would come out and eat with us. First grade, little white building, right? I remember distinctively, a little white building sitting right off behind this building. Grades 1 through 3 were there. Grades 4, 5, and 6 was in this wing. Grades 7, 8 was in that wing, pointing south. And my senior career was in the newly built wing. That wing was constructed about 1965, 66, I recollect. Being a student here offered us a unique insight into humanity, into loving your neighbor, into pride. I remember the lady principal told us at one time, I think I must have been a junior, a freshman or sophomore, that when the superintendent would visit this school, he had plenty comments, but one of the biggest compliments was always, your kids are the best dressed kids in the county. I remember that very well. A little tidbit, back when we were coming up, blue jeans were not hip. If you wore blue jeans at school, you were, how can I say this? You were the working class kid. We didn't wear blue jeans at school. We wore blue jeans to work. In fact, I got my first pair of blue jeans my first year teaching in 1973. We were very, very well dressed. Our parents, we were not rich, by no means. We went to school, we came to school, we were clean. We were well taken care of. I remember some of my teachers. My first grade teacher was a lady by the name of Miss Bradley. I remember she had a twin. My second grade teacher was Miss Kelly. My third grade teacher was Miss Cook. My fourth grade teacher, Miss Lett, later became Miss Lee. My fifth grade teacher, it's kind of funny. I don't remember. My sixth grade teacher was Miss Henry. My seventh, then we began to change classes. Then I had several teachers. I had several teachers at that particular point in time. My sister became a teacher, I guess when I must have been ninth or tenth grade, but she always taught elementary, she never taught me. A cousin of mine, Mrs. Jenright, she also taught here. By the way, she's still teaching at Summerdale School. She didn't teach me as well, she was elementary. The school actually became a high school in 1967. We graduated three classes, the class of 67, 68, and 69 as a high school. When it closed in 1969, that was the year I graduated, the school closed because of integration. It opened up again in 1973 as Foley Miller School, and ironically, I got my first job teaching here where I had gone to school all those years. And my classroom was right down the hall in room 13. We were transported by the buses. I'm not going to say I had to walk 20 miles because we didn't. Personally, we were transported. We had buses. Again, even when I was in school, we had student. I was never a student driver, but we did have student drivers. Until I graduated, there were student drivers that were capable of driving school buses. I never was a driver, but we had student drivers. Because of the economics of the area, I guess, or the inequities in education, I knew nothing. I didn't know what a locker was. I only knew about a gymnasium. We went to play in the high school gymnasium. We didn't have a gymnasium. We practiced and we played our little basketball games out back. We had a football team for 3 years. We had a band for 3 years. I was in the band. We had a band for 3 years. We had track. We had baseball. And those are pretty much the only sports we had in basketball. And I ran track, played basketball, played baseball, didn't play football. I was in the band. Academically, being from a small school, I believe we were as prepared as anyone. I remember personally going off to college. I didn't feel inferior. I made good grades. I succeeded. I graduated. As far as the type of education we got, it was state-of-the-art, as far as we knew. You know, those things you don't know, you can't miss what you don't have. But the teachers that taught us, they taught us very, very well. And the last 3 years of my education, I was exposed to my first Caucasian teachers. The Board of Education sent two Caucasian teachers down here, a Reverend C.W. McCullough, who was a missionary. He used to talk about his experiences when he was in Africa. he taught social studies, and Reverend Shelton taught driver's education. In fact, Reverend Shelton has a private school now in Robertsdale, Central Christian. He started teaching right here as a driver's ed teacher, and he was my driver's ed teacher. But those were our two Caucasian teachers when I was in my last 3 years of high school down here. I graduated number two of the class. I was salutatorian, and it was a big honor. I was beat out by a girl, Louise Ankum from Lillian. She was the valedictorian of the class. And we were small in number. I have an ARCA there that shows it was 37 in my graduating class, and I graduated number two out of that graduating class, which was a big, big honor because my mom and my sisters and brothers, they stressed education. I was thinking the other night, my mom probably got a 6th or 7th grade education, but I didn't do much. I didn't do any playing. I did nothing until I got my homework done. She saw to it every afternoon, do your homework, do your homework. And I remember as a kid sitting down, the one thing that I would do almost every night, I would read the Bible to her or with her. That's the one thing I would do almost every night. She and I would sit down and read the Bible. And I guess because of that, that's why I have a love of reading today. I graduated from Alabama State University in 1973. That was also the year that Foley Miller School, this particular site, became a middle school. And I also was one of the first faculty members hired by Coach Ivan Jones. I taught 7th and 8th grade social studies. My classroom was classroom number 13. After we moved from this particular site, the Foley Miller School moved to its present site, which was then Foley High School. I taught there for several years. After teaching there, I became assistant principal. I was assistant principal there for 7 years. I became principal of Foley Miller School after serving assistant, bus driver, teacher. And finally, I got promoted to my present position, which is school safety coordinator. So you see, being a Baldwin County Foley native, this is home for me. I wouldn't want to be anyplace else. My whole education career have been spent in South Baldwin County. And I think that's a testament to the county itself for giving me the opportunities that I've had. A lot of people my age have had several different jobs in their career. But I'm an educator. I don't care what my title is. I will always feel that I am an educator. I think I was born to do that. The evergreens that are planted on the south side of the campus, they're huge now, probably 20 feet tall. We planted, I remember, about a half a dozen of them. And one of my PE classes, we did that as students. I must have been about 10th grade. We got out there and we did that. Another thing that I didn't know really existed as a student here, janitorial service. The students were pretty much the janitors of the school. We swept up after school or actually during school. Little arts and end things like planting those trees, we all did that. I guess because the county didn't allot monies for those things for certain schools in the county. As a senior, I remember very, very well the teachers, especially those from Mobile, you know, young guys are attracted to new cars. They would buy the finest cars. Maybe why I always wanted to be a teacher, because those were the folks I was exposed to. They wore nice clothes, they drove nice cars. I remember Mrs. Bass. In fact, she's still a family friend, she's still teaching. Mrs. Juliet Bass lived in Mobile, but she bought a 1968 GTO Pontiac. I feel, thinking about it now, I feel good in that I was one of the few, if not the only one, that she trusted as a student to drive her new car. many days, she would give me the keys. I would go up to the Dairy Queen and purchase lunch for her and her friends. My sister was one of her friends. She was teaching at the time. I was junior, senior in high school. And I, you know, being a 16-year-old, that shows you the type of person my teachers saw me as. And it wasn't just me, but, you know, all the young men back then, they knew, they gave us those car keys. We were going to treat that car better than if it was ours because we wanted to drive it again. And we would do that. We didn't abuse it. And we didn't, personally, I didn't, may I borrow your car? I didn't do that. But when she said, hey, what about running to the Dairy Queen to get us lunch? She gave me the keys and I went. Brand new car. And again, things like that helped me shape my character. In fact, if I can just throw this in, I was watching some of the news last night and Katie Couric asked some of the contenders for president, what do they fear losing most? One said, my character and my good name. That's the way I feel. And my mama used to tell me, she said, you know, a good name, a good character will travel further than your human body ever will. And I have lived by that all of my life. And I believe that. A good name and good character, doing a good job. And I was brought up to not only do a good job, do the best job you can. You possibly can, and I live by that daily. I remember we had coal piles in the back. One day, one of my cousins, Eddie Lee was his name, were throwing coal and hit me right under my eye with coal. And when I got home, my mother, this is a true story now, my mother asked, what happened to your eye? For some reason, I couldn't tell her Eddie Lee, my cousin, hit me with a piece of coal. I told her I fell on it, and that's the true story. I said, I fell on the coal. We were running and playing, and I fell and hit my eye. But in actuality, he had thrown and hit me in my eye. And that's the true story. What else can I think of that? Oh, yeah, she knew I wouldn't lie.
Days at Foley, at that time it was called Foley Color School. I came here from Grove School, which was one of the Rosenwald schools in Marlow. I came here as a fourth grade grader at that time. And our school was on the corner of Michigan and Cedar Street. At that time, I don't think we had street names. But that's where I started school, in a one schoolroom building, wood building. We had about three classes in the room. And so I attended there until I got in seventh grade. Attended there seventh grade. And then after seventh grade, we were moved to this school, which still at that time was not named Aaronville School. It was still Foley Color School until later it became Aaronville School. So while here, I had some very good experiences, in spite of the insufficient of things that we did have, but it was very good times. I remember some of the teachers I had. The teachers worked as hard as they could with what they had. It was so many kids sometimes in a classroom that they couldn't devote a one-to-one as they should have. But most time we were so disciplined that they didn't have to do the discipline part. We were here to just soak in whatever we could, most of us. And I remember some of the things we had at school. First thing, we had outside toilets, of course. We had the big old pot stove or heater that we would have to go out and get coal or wood, and it didn't make any difference who we were, girls, boys, whatever, we had to go and get them and keep the fire going. And of course, in the rain, in the cold, whatever. So when going back, when I was at the first school, the one on the corner, we had to walk down here for lunch every day. So we walked about the six or seven blocks to this school. And the principal here would have a big pot of tomato soup cooked. And we would have warm tomato soup and crackers, and some days a big pot of beans, and this was served on the outside because we didn't have a cafeteria or anything. So after lunch, in the rain maybe, in the cold, we had to walk back to our school for the rest of the day. And then coming down here as a student, some of the activities we had May Day, which was a very festival time. We had different little games that we played, had a sliding board, just had the minimum of things that kids have, but we made up our games, which was good, and our teachers carried us out for PE, and we were able to do that. So I stayed here until ninth grade, and after ninth grade, we rode the bus to Daphne for 10th, 11th, and grade, 12th grade, which was a good experience. But sometimes it would be night when we get up, dark, and it would be dark when we come home in the afternoon. We had to do our chores, of course, and then we had to do our homework. But all of this, I'm saying, to make me a better person. I was able to achieve, although with all the challenges that we had. After I finished our Foley School here, Miss Mathis was our principal, Florence Mathis. She's gone now. She was one of the principals, and I loved her very dearly because she believed in me. And she told me one day that you will succeed. And any little thing that she could encourage people, she did. And some of my other teachers I remember, I had William Mitchell, and I had his wife, Helen Mitchell, which both were deceased at this time. Helen Mitchell taught us language arts. And I remember as extracurriculum things on her free time, she would teach us things as embroidering, crocheting, and I still have that skill today, thanks to her. So when I left here and went to Daphne, saying that we rode the bus, which was an experience, of course we got to meet new people and new friends, but it was kind of tiresome. It was a challenge also to get up that early in the morning, and we had to walk from our house to the bus stop. Nevertheless, the bus would pass right by my house, but I still have to leave that and go in the corner and wait on the bus. And we had to do that when it was raining, cold, whatever. But we made it. And Daphne, we had a lot of different activities, such as band, which I played in the band. We had the chorus, which I sang in the chorus. And we had different things as chemistry and good chemistry teacher. And we had French. We didn't have Spanish at the time. I took the French. So after we stayed there 12 years, we graduated. And after graduation, I went to Alabama State University. I went there, got my bachelor's there. I taught here. I came back to my school to give back to the community something that I had received. I taught at this school for 8 years. And then during the time they was integrating the school, I was moved to Foley Middle School, a high school. I was moved to Foley Elementary School. Whereas in the elementary school there, I taught sixth grade for 1 year. And then I decided, I said, well, I'm going to leave. I'm going to just leave and visit another place. My brother was living in California, so I went to visit him. I had not planned to stay out there, but I had a girlfriend and her husband there, and they were teaching. So they asked me to go down and apply for a job, and I told them no, I didn't need to do that because I had my job here as a teacher, and I had really, really planned to come back to teach. But I went down just to satisfy them, and we had to have a test, not knowing that I would pass the test and hoping that I didn't pass. So I had to come home because my husband was seriously ill at that time. So I came home, and they kept up with the results of the test. So they finally called me one day and said, you passed, and I was shocked. So after she said that, I immediately packed my clothes and I moved to California. So I got a job right away, and I taught there for 39 years. And then after then, I came back and I retired, built a home back here in Foley, good old Alabama, and I retired after 39 years of teaching. Okay, one of the stories, one of the kind of humor story that I could tell, Mr. Mitchell taught us spelling. He would often have spelling bees, and one other lady, girl at that time, and myself, we were the top spellers. And we would get so tickled, we would start laughing. And at that time, he would make us hold water in our mouth. And so one day, he decided to have us to hold water in the mouth. We decided we would get on each side of him. So as we laughed, we made sure we sprayed water all over him. So that stopped him from having us to hold water. Then he had us putting bubble gum in our mouth. We would chew bubble gum, just plenty of it. So what did we do? We sat there and we blew bubbles and burst them in front of the kids. So those were some of the funny things that we had here, that I had. But as I said, they were enjoyable time. We still got our lesson. And at that time, I think I was about the first person could outspell anyone. And so it was good. And then went to Daphne, funny stories. At first, we were bashful because we came from here and didn't know anyone in Daphne. But after we got there, we met all the other girls and boys, and to see how friendly they were, we were satisfied, and we teamed up with some of those. And there were nothing at Daphne that I wouldn't try. If it was a band, if it was cheerleader, if it was dancing on the Watusi, what they said, those things I did. I was determined that I was going to do it, and I was going to mix, and I was going to make it, and I did. I remember the chaconcily we had. I think our teacher, our principal teacher, she was still a teacher too, Miss Mathis, named it that. I don't know where she got the name from, but it's chaconcily. And it didn't start until after I was teaching here. So during that time, we would have to have two dances with our kids, and it was a form of teaching them a different dance from what they already knew. So I remember trying to find a dance not like this. My sister worked for Dr. Van Weasel. So he had two daughters, and I asked one of the daughters if I could go down and she would teach my kids a dance. So I carried four of my kids there, and they taught them a dance like an Indian dance, and I came back and they taught it to the rest of my kids. And so that was one of the dances we had. Then we had our own dance in which the kids would do. And so every night we would have, every grade here would have to have two. And the parents were excited because this was something for them to do, very excited. And the kids were very good at that. And going back, I remember when my first year of teaching here, I had fifth grade. And at that time, I didn't know that I had a slow class or special ed because they weren't identified. But I noticed that I had a whole class full, and I had one child in there who was better than, as far as education-wise, as the other. So his name was Leonard Barnett. So I made sure that I had to change him for another student because I needed to work more intensely with those kids that I had. But there was one thing that I could teach them to do. One girl, I could only teach her to spell part of her name. Her name was Magnolia. The only thing I could teach her to do, and she was in fifth grade, was M-A-G. So she got that. But I taught that whole class to play the flutophone. So we performed at PTA and at Christmas, playing the flutophone and playing the songs. And she was one of them that achieved that. And I was so proud of that class. I can mention a lot of more kids like Michael McGowan, Pettibone Boy. All of those were in my class, and they learned to do that. And I had a lot of respect for them. They respected me. And the final thing that I would like to say, I appreciate all of my students that I had here. Some I can name, and some I can't because it was a long time ago. Remember, it was 39 years ago. And I've gotten a little older, a little tired now, but I still meet some of you I know, and you speak to me, and I may not remember your name, but you're still in my heart. I still love you, I still respect you, and I love your parents, and I appreciate the work that they did with me to bring you to where you are. And some of you are very successful. I'm proud of you, and continue to be the way you are.